As the world fell, it was hard to know who was more crazy.
Help us, man. You promised to help us.
Me. Or everyone else.
This is a very kinetic movie.
This was an exciting one for me.
There'd always be something amazing going on.
This wasn't going to be a run-of-the-mill big movie. It's just going to be rock and roll.
A lot of movies have the talky bits and they have the action bits. In this case, they were happening together.
The first half of the film is an enormous chase. The second half of the film is a race. War-to-war action.
George and Brendan McCarthy and a couple of other storyboard artists basically wrote the story in storyboards. It was built from graphic. More like putting together a comic, and how do you tell that story in a visual? So it was fantastic while it moved forward, but it was completely irritating if you suddenly decided one of your characters only had one arm and you had to go back and redraw 90% of the storyboards to reflect that fact.
It was indeed something which was pretty non-verbal. I mean, people obviously speak in the movie, but they speak only when it's necessary.
It was all in George's head, and he was using Brendan and myself to visualise those ideas. And so through that course of 2 years, we were slowly surrounded by more and more storyboards. So it got to the point where anyone that came into this room would have to wade through loads of storyboards pinned to these display boards.
It was 3,500 panels around a room, and I would say a good 80% of those panels are reflected in the images you see on the screen today.
The visuals on them were epic. And he managed to not only capture them, but he captured them with a very limited amount of CGI.
What these storyboards did is it told us which car was going around, which crash, who was on it. And so gradually you could break it down, as one has to, and be very accurate as to how long it would take to shoot and how you'd want to shoot it.
The long chase and race that is the backbone of the film requires not just a desert, because visually it gets a bit tedious after a while, but needs four or five different flavours of nothing. And I hope that's what we've found here in beautiful Namibia.
I mean, if you look at this movie, it's 140 vehicles driving at 140 miles an hour, 140 kilometres. The distances involved and what we're doing are huge. The challenge from a production side was very much to bring all that facility and all that resource to hand so that George had the ability to go big, go wide, go small, go fast.
The whole film is on the move, so your set is constantly moving through a very dusty environment, 50, 60 kilometres an hour.
We didn't breathe for 8 months making this film. There's a great challenge, just logistically, you know, trying to dramatize a story that's in constant movement is very, very tricky.
Action!
It does definitely create some challenges being on the move all the time. First of all, everything has to be done radio remotely.
For us, each vehicle had its own unique environment where we could rig from, where we could get performers to perform an action without them falling off the thing, to how to cover the rigging up so it doesn't look so obvious in shot.
Nothing ever goes out on set that hasn't been tested completely. We wouldn't allow it to.
It feels to me like opera because it's so big, it's so expansive. It's a blend between reality but awesome, huge spectacle.
None of it defies the laws of physics. It's not people flying or space vehicles or anything like that.
All
all the crashes are real crashes, all the cars are real cars, all the stunts are real stunts. You know, we have a lot of CG assist in removals of safety cables and to help with the backgrounds. But it was really about trying to go back to the roots of Mad Max 1 and Road Warrior Mad Max 2 to get that kinetic energy on camera.
I'm kind of averse to 100% CG shots. If it can be avoided, I always love to have some practical live action element in there to ground the shot. Even if you end up virtually replacing everything, it still inherits something from the original live action that is a valuable thing.
I was just speechless when I saw the shot of the Armada going across the desert where we meet Max, and his muzzle is on the front of Nux's vehicle. And there's this incredible shot on the edge arm that starts on Max in profile, and we see Nux and go up to slit, and then it comes around to the Tacoma and the Doof mobile. Like, this is the most jaw-dropping shot I've ever seen.
95% of what I shot on the action unit was shot on the move, and we shot it all from an edge arm. And you know, that's a piece of technology that was never around during Mad Max 2 days, and it's still literally quite new, and the way that we used, I think, is even newer again. So that was a really big thing, being able to, you know, to be constantly on the move with the camera.
One of my first concerns, having shot quite a few movies in the desert, is dust. It always is. It gets into everything. It affects basically everything that's used on a film. And one of the first things I brought up in one of the early meetings was, are we going to be needed to try and control the dust in the environment? And his answer was, no, dust is our friend.
We got used to it, but it was extreme, even so much that some days we had to stop shooting because the drivers couldn't see where they were going. But it's also amazing what they can do in the conditions that we shot in.
Okay, guys, just get out.
The locations really did become a major part of how you determine what the sequence would be. We were never restricted. In Namibia, we had nothing but open spaces, so there was never a thought of trying to frame something out so you could actually include the frame totally. So it was just a unique landscape.
So this will be all the vehicles on this speed run, the whole group. There'll be a flash effect on the car, which will indicate when the cannon starts. Roll cameras, please.
The idea of the black-on-black roll was obviously the very first stunt in the film. And so we were trying to work out how we could do that in a very different way, but was still incredibly dynamic, and how we got around the normal problems that you have with rolling a car at really high speed.
If you look at Road Warrior, we did a stunt which now is quite famous, in which guy does what they call a T-bone, who's going for a world record, where he's on a motorbike and he hits a vehicle which has just rolled and he flips. But what had happened is that his leg clipped it and he went into relaxation mode, knowing that he was injured. So now, all these years later, he wanted to do this roll, and he wanted to roll a car in sand more than anyone else had done before.
And so we started working with the special effects guys.
We aided them with a flipper, which is a different type of car spinning device, along the same lines as a nitrogen cannon, but it's actually a mechanical foot which comes down underneath the car and lifts one side off the ground. And again, as the guys steer into the turn and the roll, the flipper hits the ground and forces the car over.
Well, let's have a good gag. Guys looking forward to it.
And it was sort of really new technology with the rollover mechanism that we had, and I was involved in sort of the testing process of it, so I really thought, well, you know, I'd like to do it. And it was one of those ones that had a whole combination of aspects. You were in extreme close proximity to other motorcycles and cars. It was very precise camera placement of where we wanted the car to actually end up. So it was really something that I felt, you know, more comfortable doing myself than sort of asking someone else to do, having done the rehearsals and understanding how the system worked. It was just one of those ones we planned to be as fast as we could possibly go, make it as good as we could possibly go, so it sort of set a bit of a tone for what's going to happen in the rest of the film.
The skills of the stunts are amazing. You've got stunt performers from every type of stunt you can do.
Probably one of the most unique gags that we've done on this show was jumping a guy called Morse off the back of the fuel pod, which is on the war rig, and he had to have two spears and stand up on the back of the pod and dive off on the move onto one of the buzzards down below. And we had to fly him off the back and stop him just above those, obviously, so he didn't spear into them. And then in a later shot, we've blown the vehicle up like he's landed on it and exploded it.
As with all of what we managed to do on the film, it was all done for real. So it was just a matter of some very good rigging. That was done by Keir Beck and his team.
That was challenging because the rig on the back of the war rig was massive, and it involved a lot of truss and a lot of, I think, five people to operate the system. There was camera guys hanging off it, so there's a lot of maths and physics, and it's very complicated. And issues are obviously the thing is on the move while we're doing this stunt.
We basically put him on a decelerator system so that we actually pulled him up literally within inches from the top of the vehicle.
Acting in a movie which is visually driven, as in watching what a character does by seeing them go through one physical event after another and how it affects them, was a very difficult story to tell.
Good shit, please.
When Tom Kane and Mitty started breaking down beat by beat by beat, why am I looking at that person? Why are they looking at me? What motivates this? And he went through everything. And that, to me, even after 35 years, I just learned so much in that conversation of just listening to Tom, the way he as an actor would break down every beat of that fight scene. And I walked away thinking, wow, I've just realized again how much more there is than just the physical. You know, it's what motivates each of those moves.
Push me out, push me out.
Out a bit, and like then that. In and out.
Yeah. Happy with that.
Boom.
And
then, stay there.
And then the shots
happy
are.
With that grip, yeah.
And then we go, and then we go
yeah,
out.
And then the shots are.
Charlize is a very talented physical person. She knows exactly where she is. She knows whether it's, you know, around the vehicle, coming in and out, on top, whether it's working with the gun. She, again, is very gifted in her ability to be able to make it look like everything she's doing as a character is something that she's been doing all of her life.
I'm not an incredibly methodly driven person or actor, but I felt like there was just nothing else to do but embrace it.
My fight with Charlize, we had something else worked out. Originally, I'm supposed to grab her, kind of breathe in her face because I'm all pissed off at her because she betrayed the Imperators as well. And then through the conversation with George, Charlize, we agreed that it's better she headbutts me. And the fact that she headbutts me kind of just brought the whole character to life again. It came out of the choreography, and that's what led to the drama.
The other fairly large sequence that we did was at Rossing Mountain, where we had Rob Jones as the rock rider chief riding off the side of the mountain, about 48 metres down into a catching net that we'd placed down the bottom with mats in it and cardboard boxes to maintain him once he'd landed.
Yeah, the catching area also.
You couldn't half rehearse it because he was going to ride off the side of a cliff.
Where they set off some of these bikes, they were on like several thousand feet drop-offs, you know, just to get the jump off a rock. It's like, God, people, you know, you look over, you get that sort of vertigo feel.
Yeah, that was pretty stressful for everyone on the first run.
We basically cherry-picked the best freestylers that we had in Australia, and incredibly talented young riders. And what we did then was take all the moves that they're most comfortable doing in an arena or as part of their own shows or in their racing careers, and we varied and changed those to fit into what we needed to do on the script.
There was one moment where I'm sitting in the back of the war rig, and Steve, one of the fantastic stunt drivers, drives the Bigfoot up a ramp in the canyon and flips it and rolls it. And I remember watching it and just being like, oh, shit, is he okay? Like, what's going on? It was another one of those moments of like, oh, I've got to carry on acting in the scene, damn, but I kind of just want to be watching that. That's awesome. It's a lot to take in, you know. It's kind of, I remember this is one of the few films where I've got chills during scenes.
These stuntmen are insane, and they're doing insane things. And I don't understand a lot of how that's even physically possible. The polecats alone, like, there are guys who are actually jumping from poles onto cars at speed.
The idea for the polecats came way back when I saw street performers on poles and they were leaning back and forward, swaying as it were, and I thought they were really interesting. So when it came to doing the movie, we designed the vehicles, but I said there's no way that we're going to have real humans on a moving vehicle. So we said, okay, let's comp them in, let's shoot the guys on the poles, and then we'll comp them into a moving vehicle. And guy did some tests and they had hydraulics and it looked puppeteered. So it looked like it wasn't in the hands of the guy doing the swinging, it was some other force.
I have a good friend, Stephen Bland, who's been part of Circus Soleil in Las Vegas for over 20 years. He was a stunt performer in Australia. And said, look, show us some of the pole work that you guys do. We just started off slowly and just went out on the road. Was a newbie for all of us. The special effects team had been working fairly solidly with George on designing a way of creating a metronome effect on the back of a vehicle that performers could be on and swing back and forth as a way of transferring from one vehicle to another.
And it was also getting a pole that was 6 meters long and sometimes longer that had enough strength, but also a little bit of flexibility to be able to put, you know, an 80 to 100 kilo actor up there and be able to get to horizontal and not bend.
The guy on the top can actually pivot and operate himself to a certain level. Additional weights or other men are bouncing off the counterweight, give him a mechanical advantage, and we can actually get him then all the way down to ground level and back up again while driving at speed.
There's no room for error. If that breaks, that person's going to be injured. So, you know, that was kind of something that we really had to be 110% on top of it.
It created for us a very intricate system that the performer also had to manage their own performance while performing and de-rigging themselves to transfer or to transfer onto something.
I brought tears to my eye. I couldn't believe it was real. So it's completely real. And I just didn't think we'd be able to do it for real. They were up there with chainsaws, they were up there with thunder sticks. They were doing all that action, and it was just wonderful.
It was one of those things that from the beginning of the shoot was, you know, not something I was always excited about. I mean, overexcited probably about. I was scared, you know, and I wasn't looking forward to it. And he strapped me on it anyway, and that was that. And it was scary.
scary. But again, you know, I was just standing at the top of it, going back and forth a bit. There was some poor bugger going out there doing it for real for weeks on those polecats. Weeks on it. Months. Every day, you know. So, you know, respect to the polecat.
I'd say the people eater fuel truck explosion is a big deal.
In movies, we see a lot of explosions, so you kind of got to do something a little different and work off the cliche. So before the main climax, we wanted a great explosion.
We had this fantastic expanse of desert, and the special effects guys had a remote control truck, which is basically three giant tankers driven by a large tractor trailer in the front. And we literally remote controlled it across the desert, and on a preordained spot, they basically blew it.
It was balletic, and I guess that in the same way that people use fireworks, they use these explosions. It had wonderful tendrils going out, and it was progressive.
There were over 1,000 litres of fuel, petrol, in the explosion, along with a lot of primer cord, which is a high explosive initiator.
It was a big event, and doing it on the move as well sort of makes it a bit more challenging.
Has to roll in an incredibly particular way and stop and wedge itself in the middle of this gap in the mountains. Again, we wanted to figure out a way that we could do it in a spectacular manner and do it for real.
Stunt guys are going to put the truck into a little bit of a slide, and then they basically hit the button. And the button is basically firing the high-pressure nitrogen into the top of the cannon. It pushes the slug out. The slug can't go anywhere because it's pushing against the ground, so the only way that gas can escape is to lift the truck off the slug.
Lee, in all the stunts, drove the war rig. So when it came to do the big climactic role of the movie, of course, Lee had to do it.
He was able to put it in spots that, you know, we could only dream of being able to put it.
The difficulty of that shot is that it had to land precisely in front of our cameras.
It's just getting the positioning right. So when I fire the button, I'm in the right position to hopefully be in the right spot, you know? That's the main thing. I'll be happy if it is.
You build up to a stunt, and there's that sort of tension that builds up.
And camera, truck movement. Action!
As I watched it on the monitors, I glimpsed Nux, but I thought it was Lee, and I thought he'd shaved his head, and the vehicle would flip right over, right onto what I thought was Nux's head through the sunroof.
He landed on his...
Everyone said it was okay. I said, but what happened? What I'd forgotten was that was Nux's dummy. And he was obviously on the other side with the full helmet and cage and so on. And when we looked at Nux's dummy, it shaved off the top of the rubber latex of the top of the dummy.
How was it?
Yeah, it was great. It
looked like it landed on your head. It did.
He hit the exact spot he needed to. It came perfectly to the camera.
Yeah, it worked well. It worked great.
The mooring is now rolled and basically filled the hole, which is Emma's rock. And because the doof is so close behind it, it basically then smashes directly into the war rig.
All of the speakers at the top here, the musical instruments, the trombones, all of those have been drilled out and have squibs inside. So when the doof wagon impacts the war rig, we have a trigger on the front of the doof wagon, which will fire off all those squibs. So then everything is basically free to move forward.
The great advantage I was able to do was to do the opening crash and the end crash. So I was able to bookend the film, which was a great feeling. We had a mark halfway down the 1 mile run up that we had an abort position. Once we passed that line, it was just staying true to the course and enjoying the view as you close very quickly on another truck at 85 kilometres an hour. Incredibly successfully. George got the shot he wanted, which was the end shot of the film. I walked away with no problems whatsoever. So I'm very happy with my career doing, you know, stunts, and I think it's time for the young fellas to have a go at a few, and I just hung my helmet up on a good one.
That's good. It looked pretty spectacular.
Oh, yeah.
That's wonderful.
Oh, fuck!